Welcome back, everybody. I hope you guys are doing good. I have another audio lined up for you guys. Won't be very long. Won't take over your time. Just a fair warning. Still on the road, so you guys are going to hear background noise. I apologize. I don't know if it's the... I don't think it's necessarily the noise. I think it's the headset that I'm using. The gate, you talk, seems like there's a lot more noise coming through than other headsets that I have. So anyway, you guys know the drill. Just bear with me. First question, all right? And you guys, the reason I'm doing these audios, because the questions are so phenomenal, all right? So the first question, and it has to do with America's dollar inflation and Russia's inflation. And so here's how it breaks down, because the question is, look, you keep talking about how countries would devalue their currency to add value to the markets. In other words, they expand their market, and that's true. But Russia is going through an inflation and the United States is going through inflation. You're saying two different things. You're saying Russia's getting hit head on, and then the United States, it's strategic. And you guys, you can't imagine how happy that makes me that someone out there actually recognizes that and can actually unpackage that and take it apart. I'm telling you right now, I get in front of a lot of people. And they have a lot of degrees, and they can't figure this stuff out. And you guys are starting to figure this stuff out. Actually, not certain. You guys have. You guys have figured this stuff out a long time ago. So it makes me absolutely – I love these conversations. It is an opportunity because you can't have these conversations with too many people. It is impossible. They just don't know how to break it down into competition. All right? So I'm going to cover that real quick. And then I'm going to go through a couple more questions here. Russia's inflation has nothing to do with expanding their market. Russia's markets are shrinking. Argentina's markets are shrinking. It's not a strategy on their end to expand their currency. So what they did, probably at the beginning of the war, maybe it was a couple months ago, the Russian ruble, the inflation was hitting it pretty hard. And so they made a couple moves, tried to stop the inflation. And it did. It kind of slowed it down. But now it's starting to pick up. All right. They're doing everything they can to stop it. The United States and Western Europe is completely opposite. What are we doing? We're trying to pay off our bills. We're trying to fight a war, a proxy war. We're pulling out, we're reshoring out of China. We're doing our infrastructure in the United States, our interstates, all this. And so what do they need to do? They need to lower the value of the currency to do it. Go through all the examples that I gave you in the last audios. Been doing it for a couple of years now. But that's the difference, is Russia, they need value added to their currency, big time. Because their economy, they don't produce anything. It's energy. And they've been blocked. 33% of their GDP came from the EU, and it's been blocked. And they're not going to get it back. There's not going to be a sunny day where it's all going to come back and, you know, oh, shucks, you know, we kind of made a mistake. Can't we all be friends. Germany and these guys, we begged them not to tie themselves to Russia. Ever since 1998, when Russia said that they were going to do all this. That's another thing that bugs the hell out of me, is people's, you know, all the reasons, like, why is Russia doing this? And yeah, 15 different reasons. Well, why don't you look at the reasons they wrote in a book and they teach at their military academy? That's probably they're going to be the reason, right? So, you know, but they told everybody what they're going to do in 1998, and they... Every step of the way, they're going to take over Chechnya. They're going to go for Georgia. They're going to go, they don't need to completely take over, but their influence is dominant. And how do they do that? Lawfare. They would have people that spoke Russian get in these countries, and then they would pretend that there was some type of discrimination against Russian-speaking people, and then they would go after them. They'd go after the people that were going after the Russians. And that's how we're going to do it, you know. And everybody was asleep at the wheel. They just let them get away with it. So that's what Russia's plan was. They're trying to reorganize and have the influence that they had when they were the USSR. And guess what? They got caught and they failed. They got away with it all the way up into Ukraine. Even if you guys remember, even if they win Ukraine, they're not going to build their empire back. This is it. The other side is China, and they're going through inflation. They're trying to expand their markets. They're trying to tell everybody, hey, look, we're part of the BRICS, and hallelujah, we're expanding our market. The problem with that is, who are they, China, who are they expanding their markets with? The fellow BRICS, right? Brazil, major inflation. Their markets are not expanding. Russia, their markets are not expanding. What about some of these countries that are offering to get into the BRICS? First tier, second tier, what difference does it make? Argentina, Iran. Yeah, they're not expanding their markets. You guys get the trend? That's it. That's all it is. But there is a major difference. You can, two countries can have inflation for completely different reasons. And so that's what's going on with Russia. And basically, that's the problem that the BRICS are going to have, because what are they doing? They're trying to attack the U.S. dollar, which is absolutely retarded, because that's what backs up all their currency. It's the U.S. dollar, the peg to the U.S. dollar. So if they want to, they should have had, if they really wanted to play that game, play devil's advocate here, they should have had a currency ready to attack the U.S. dollar before they started this. But no, if you sit down, you put it on piece paper, and you think about the moves that have been made, it's literally retarded. Their manufacturing will never come close to Japan, the United States, Western Europe. It just simply won't. They will not have the customers that we have. They don't have the technology that we have. And if they do have the technology they have, they still don't have the customers. It's a never-ending losing cycle. All right, so we have the customer base. We have the workforce base. We have the people that are educated enough that need and want to buy the high-end, high-tech stuff. You know, think about it, you guys. Why would you, let's say you're in Peru. Why would you need a high-end computer? You can't afford that. Not only that, but you can't have access to the software that can be used on a computer like that. Not only that, but you don't have internet access or anything like that, like we do here in you know, the first world countries. So it's not like you just go out and do all this. We are the market. The high-end stuff, if China was to build high-end technology to compete with the West, they'd have to sell it to us. They can't sell it to these third world countries. Their infrastructure is not set up to handle that stuff. We have fiber optics. We have Starlink. We have internet coming from satellites. They don't have any of that. None of it. So think about that. And so they would have to build, the BRICS would have to completely build that. And it's something that we already have. Not only that, but what they're trying to build is a little bit by little bit, becoming obsolete in the West. So they're always going to be that far behind, which is a lot. There's just too much for them to make up. The next thing is Italy, all right? So when we go back to the Belt Road Initiative for China, and what are they doing? They're trying to build access to markets. That's all it is. The Belt Road Initiative, the Chinese Belt Road Initiative, is to expand their markets, more customers. And one of the, it's a huge, huge deal, you guys, and that is Italy pulled out of their trade agreement with China. And the reason that has got a major effect on China, because Italy was their gateway to Western Europe. They were going to go through the South China Sea to the Indian Ocean, through the Suez Canal to Italy, and then their products would make it to Western Europe. And it is evaporated. It's gone. That was their main vein as of now. You know, they still want to go across India, Pakistan, and all that stuff. And you guys have actually taken my course. You know, those maps have every one of those routes. It even has India's routes on how to compete with China, trying to compete with India in the West, how the West competes with those guys, all the interconnecting maps and the routes that we use to expand our market. And that's what it's all about. Believe it or not, all these wars are about that. That is it. So just wanted to give you guys an update. Huge news on Italy pulling out of that trade agreement. Russia's inflation is completely different from ours. We're doing it specifically to expand our market. They're trying to get their head above water so they can breathe, because they're losing customers. So it's a big difference. And by the way, you guys need to pay attention. And I know you guys are. You need to pay attention to Russia's economy, because there were some moves they can pull up to now. And you guys are running out of cards. They're simply running out of economic cards. And it's going to be interesting on how it unfolds. Russia can go to war for the next 10 years. All right, but what about their economy? You know, people are going to start to rebel. Not only that, but Putin's not a guy that just one day decided, I'm going to be the leader of Russia. It was a group that backed him. They hired him to represent their power base, and he had to be qualified. You know, he's happened to be part of the KGB, right? He's like the CEO of Russia. Well, these guys can, you know, they don't have to keep him around. So what they can do is they can all these screw ups, and I wouldn't call them screw ups, but they just simply failed. All right, they simply failed, and they can blame it on him and put somebody else and do trade with the West. That's what we have to stop here and from happening from Western Europe and the United States, is let them hit that reset button. And the only way they can hit that reset button is Putin walks away, or if they get rid of him or something like that. And that's the biggest threat we have coming from Russia. Other than that, they are in, you know, they've been in containment since the end of World War II. And they haven't been able to break out of it. They're not about to break out of it. We have more power over them than what we did the Cold War, you know. And now we're going to put China in that same position. So if China wants to know what's going on or what their future is, all they have to do is look at what Russia has gone through. They lost the Cold War, and they lost the Cold War big time, and they know it. And so the strategy that you guys are, we're living in right now is Russia acknowledging how they lost. And then that's what that book, The Foundation of Geopolitics, is all about. It's about correcting all that and then going for the rimland, which Japan went for the rimland. That was their strategy, World War II. Germany, that was their strategy. You know, they were the railroad from Baghdad to, from Berlin to Baghdad was their gateway, the east, and they wanted to get to India and then, you know, start gaining control of that two-thirds of the world population that's on that. So you guys, everybody is after the Chinese have the same strategy as the Japanese in World War II. The Japanese have the same strategy as the Germans, and the Russians have the same strategy. And what is our balance from the West, from the British at the time when this stuff, when we learned about this stuff, the British actually controlled all this. So their objective was to keep everybody off the jewel, which was India, you know, the jewel of the British Empire, okay, the great game. And it's still that, but it's a little bit different. Now that the United States is in control, our every strategy that we have. So I want you to think about this from all the conspiracy theories and stuff that are out there. Why we are in Iraq, why we are in Afghanistan, what happened in Vietnam, what happened in South Korea. And you guys, simply, we made the observation that can't have anybody control the rimland, because then they can compete against us. And we've talked about this, but that's it. So think about this. Let's narrow this down to where it's crystal clear, right? What is the objective of the Nazis? Well, to take over the rimland, take over the world's population, and use that population to build and manufacture. Manufacturing builds wealth, and wealth builds power. What do you think China's strategy is? What do you think Japan? Japan was going to meet Germany in the middle. Who knows how that would have ended up if they met in the middle. But they were allies. Exact same strategy. Russia has that exact same strategy. And ours is a little bit different from everybody else's. We're not necessarily, we don't need to, but from, think about from a regional perspective, from Iraq. It was Saddam Hussein, right? We didn't want him to gain power. And then if he gained enough power, then the Russians would say, hey, you know, let's team up. We can expand your regional power. And so we blocked it. Same thing with Iran. What do you guys think we have a problem with Iran for? Because they have regional aspiration. They want to expand. And Russia's like, hey, that's cool. We'll back you. Because your expansion shrinks the American influence. And so that's what we do. We break up parties. We break up religions. We break up regional powers. So they can't gain and pool together and become some type of regional or continental empire. It's very simple. You guys have to sit down and contemplate that for a while, because that's why we're in Iraq. That's why we're in Afghanistan. If we make any moves in any of those territories, again, it has to do with the exact same thing. It is the war on terror. It is all that stuff. But that's the definition of the operations that we're putting together. You know, we didn't want radical Islam to gain control in areas. So they can team up and start building influence. And the next thing you know, they have regional influence. The next thing you know, they have imperialistic ambitions. And the next thing you know, we have to fight them. So that's what we're stopping. And it's nothing new under the sun. We did that when the United States was the 13 colonies, and we had the principle from coast to coast. All right. So think about what we just talked about with the rimland. Now think about the United States, how we expanded. What was their strategy? When it was the original 13 colonies, what did we have behind us? The French. And then the North, we in Canada, we had the British. And then you had Mexico. And so that was our philosophy. Just like on the rimland, don't anybody forming a power that can encroach on our sovereignty. So that's what we did with the Indians, all that stuff. It's like, what was our philosophy with the Indians? Like, well, they were just prejudiced. They said, no. Anybody that wasn't going to be part of the United States was a potential they could build allies. What did the French do with the French and the English? And the French had Indian allies and the English had Indian allies. So that's what we were afraid of. We were afraid of any type of, on the continent, in the United States, North America, we were afraid of any type of combination of competition from the French, from the English. And so our strategy was to go from coast to coast, block everybody from coast to coast, and go up as far as north as we can, which is what is Canada, and far as south as what we can, which ended up being Mexico. We pushed Mexico down. So nothing different, right? So that's been America's philosophy from, or our policy, our strategy, the way we think from day one, ladies and gentlemen. That same type of thinking, even though it was not systemized, because we didn't know exactly what the world looked like. Everything hadn't been discovered yet. And then, so when geopolitics came along in 1904, and they invented geopolitics and the art of geopolitics because we knew where everything was at, our thinking, our policy, our strategies never changed. So you go from protecting the United States, and what was our the natural barriers was the ocean. And so once we involved with World War One, World War Two, we watched Europe and the wars, and were involved with them, and we realized what manufacturing can do, and we realized if anybody took over the Rimland after the British had mostly controlled it, that they can out manufacture us, and these oceans won't mean anything. They can just swarm with boats. They can take over South America. They can take over Central America. They can just out manufacture us that way. And the world island can literally engulf the outer islands, they call them. And that's the exact geopolitical terminology. They can, the world island empire can definitely beat individual, island, powers, North America, Central America, South America, the population of Africa, Europe, Asia, complete is way bigger than what we have here in North, Central, and South America. So that's how we think. It's everything. It has nothing to do with space aliens. It has nothing to do with this New World Order bullshit. None of it. It's not even a reality. Those terms don't even come up. You know, so it's all this competition going on, and you got people out there saying how everything is under one bucket and the all-seeing eye, and it's like, all right, if that's true, they're failing. But it's not. It has nothing to do with anything. It just simply does not exist, and it will not exist. And what's absolutely just blows my mind is the country that want to compete against the United States. They're doing what they're accusing everybody of doing. It's like, oh, you guys are just trying to. In a new world order. What's Russia trying to do? They're trying to create a freaking new world order. They're the ones who decided to create, they're the ones who proposed about the BRICS and have an economic tie with China. It was the Russians. It wasn't the Chinese or the Brazilians or, that's what they're trying to create, a world order. So it's completely opposite. You know what I mean? It's very strange. But something to think about, you guys. Think about what the United States did. And I don't want to hear any shit what happened with the, how cruel people were with the Indians, stuff like that. Obviously, it's a sin. But what is strategy? What were we thinking when we did that? We were thinking, we're looking at our past history and the world, and these European countries were not going to stop. They're going to keep coming at us, keep coming, just like the English when they finally conquered France and they stopped the attack from the Catholic Irish coming across. And that whole war, what do they say? These guys are never going to stop. They are the evil empire. They're never going to stop. Like, who does this? Year after year, 200 years of bullshit, 200 years of murder, rape, and pillage, and we're sick of it. That's what Cromwell's speech was, all right? So that was the concepts that was fresh in people's minds when the United States was created. So we knew the English wasn't going to try to stop one day. They were just going to fold up and they're going to try to take over the continent. That's the whole, it's the whole reason for them being here. Same thing with all the other countries. So that's why they came up with the strategy from coast to coast. And that is, and so what do they call that? They call that, how do they sell that to the people? Our manifest destiny, the great destiny of, and that's how they sell that stuff. That's how they put that stuff together. Well, Russia's going through theirs, but they're getting their asses. That's what they tried to create through all this propaganda. They went from communism to Orthodox Christianity, and Jesus likes them now. And we're all, it's all insane, all right? It's all of it's insane. But that's the real world, right? That is, it's not Sunday school. That's reality. And so nothing new under the sun. Very easy. There is no mysteries here. There's no mystery group. There's no mystery secret society. It's all in the open. It's right. We're all fighting for the same thing. We just happen to control it. We just simply happen to control it. But any more? Well, actually, one more. you guys, I'm getting like literally 1,000 emails a day on people asking me about Warka and going to Warka, and I'm not going to answer any of those questions. A, I don't have any contact with Warka. The contact that we had with Warka is a former employee. That's it. He doesn't work for Warka. So a long time ago, I said I'm not Warka's help desk, and I'm not today. And there's a lot of friends that I have that I've talked to in the past, and you know, thinking that I'll give them some a wink. You guys, I don't have anything. So if you have anything or you have a contact, you share it with me. If you're going to go to Iraq and try to get your money out of work and all this stuff, hey, let me know how you did it. I'll do an interview with you on. I don't know how to do it. I'm not set up that way. So back in the day, I had a lot of contacts with Warka, but you guys, it just dropped off the radar. Just simply dropped off the radar. So I don't have any contacts. So if you have a Warka account and you ever got a response, whoever gave you that response, whatever name is on that, that's it. That's all there is. So, but that's it. And I'm not saying that because I'm angry that people ask me for, help or anything like that. That's not it, you guys. I just don't have the information, and it's starting to get to where I can't even respond to all the emails because so many people are asking me. I don't have that type of information. If I did have it, I would give it to you all in a second. Like, why wouldn't I? It's not a secret, right? I'm not going to gain anything by keeping it a, you know, I'm going to help you in 2 seconds. I just don't have that information. So, I apologize. But if you guys do have contact or get in contact and you want to share, you'll be helping a lot of people. So, keep me posted on how you guys are doing this and all that stuff. And it's great to get email from people I haven't talked to in a long time. It's good to hear from you guys. I'm not kidding. So, look, everybody, any more questions? Like I said, the question with Russia and inflation is fantastic. I love this stuff. All right. I love the fact that you guys are asking those type of questions because that's in depth. You know, you definitely have, you're there when you can ask those type of questions. But until the next time, everybody, look forward to your email. Look forward to your questions. Brightlingcurrency@gmail.com. Anybody have any questions? And you guys, send me enough. I'll, you know, pull in a bunch of questions, and I'll put another audio up for you. And until the next time, everybody, God bless. Thanks all.